Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the latest in our series of inaugural lectures here at Keele. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Trevor McMillan. I have the privilege of being the Vice-Chancellor here at Keele. And it is my great pleasure indeed to welcome all of you here, colleagues of Paul's, friends of Paul, family in particular, I think, of Paul. As I always say at these functions, the inaugural lecture series is an important marker for the university. It's important for the university to be able to show off our talent. It's an important time for our lecturer to be able to show how they can truly address the breadth and indeed the depth of their discipline to the level that warrants the professorial title. That, as we know, is not an easy thing to do for a very mixed audience. As I've, again, I think said one or two times from this stage, I think bringing the family with you is always a very good idea, especially if they're ready to laugh at dad's jokes, okay? So that's the key thing. But as I say, this is an important marker, and it's a great pleasure to have Paul Horrocks give his inaugural lecture this evening. Paul gained his bachelor's in biochemistry and applied molecular biology from UMIST in 1992. He then embarked on his PhD at the University of Edinburgh, working on the molecular control of DNA replication in the human malarial parasite. He followed that with a postdoctoral position at the University of Würzburg in Germany, which of those of us who are radiobiologists in the room was the home of the discovery of X-rays. After 2 years, he returned to the University of Oxford, and there he worked at the Institute of Molecular Medicine. And there, the interesting link with Keele is that the first director of that institute was David Wetherill, who, of course, was our chancellor here for 10 years. In 2005, Paul came to Keele within the Centre for Applied Entomology and Parasitology, and while here, he has clearly worked on leishmaniasis and trypanosomiasis. I knew I'd get that wrong, with an interest in the discovery of the new antiparasitic compounds. Overall, Paul has over 60 research papers and reviews, but I think it's important to recognise that this promotion to professor also recognises his teaching and learning role within the School of Medicine. We're keen at Keele to make sure that we have that balance within our staff. That role is perhaps best evidenced by his track record of student nominations for the Teaching Excellence Award and him winning twice the Keele Student Union Prize for Superb Supervisor. So today, Paul will take us through his work over the last 25 years. I'm sure it doesn't feel like 25 years. With his work with the malaria parasite and his inaugural lecture entitled Tackling Malaria, the Biology, Pathophysiology, and Death of the Parasite. Ladies and gentlemen, Professor Paul Horrocks.
Okay, so it's a pleasure to actually to welcome so many people. I didn't quite appreciate that I knew so many people working within the Keele University, as well as friends and family and so on like that. So, do you know, actually, I was just reflecting a moment ago there that everyone says, enjoy the moment, but you spend so long planning for the moment, and then actually just one moment there while we're outside, and actually I just found the thought, actually, you know, it's really nice. It's actually quite special. And I think also what's special as well is that, you know, I recognise that in planning for the preparation for this talk, I've been to lots of other inaugurals, and It's the contemporaries that I've actually shared that with, and it's been a real pleasure and privilege actually to be made a professor at the same time, and I have written down names just to make sure I don't forget anybody. But Nick Forsyth, Rose Fricker, Frederick Trippe, Rob Kirby, Divya Chari, and down in the London School, David Baker. And I've been to all of their inaugurals, and it's just really nice to actually have your contemporaries and be recognised at the same time as your contemporaries and actually go and share time with them. Now, the other thing is you look at their talks and you go, what seems to be working here? Because you've got to do something. And you do get a letter of invitation that says, you know, this is the date your inaugural is going to be. P.S. Make it interesting. And I was talking to head of school, Andy Hassel, a couple of weeks ago about something else. And he says, it is going to be interesting, isn't it? You're not going to talk about the other stuff that you talked about last time. So, yes. So I went back, scratched all of those slides. And actually, whilst I was, I spent a day, a couple of Thursdays ago, happily making my slides and sat down with my wife at the end and said, what do you think? And she's clicking through. She goes, they're pretty slides. But you just can't make molecular biology interesting. So that's the challenge for today. So, okay, presentation. So one thing that works is pictures. Okay, so this is me, aged just slightly older than my son, Joseph, at the bottom down here. I'm probably 7 years old, and I know this because my sister is in the picture as well. And at this point, my mum assures me that I was committed to a career in science. In fact, I wanted to be a mad scientist. I'm halfway there, I suspect. And you make up your mind. So this is me, 1992. I went to UMIST, no longer existing, unfortunately, but the University of Manchester Institute of Science and Technology. I was fascinated from an early age about how cells worked. I loved biology, I loved chemistry, I loved physics at school. And so the idea of going to university where you could actually immerse yourself in germs and doing that, that was great for me. And particularly, it was the applied part. I wanted to know how to do the molecular biology, how to genetically manipulate organisms. And so I went to UMIST, and this is a picture of the building on Sackville Street, and it's an unusual one because here Archimedes doesn't have a traffic cone on his head, which he usually does. So after when I was at UMIST, I did my honours project, and so in 1992 I did my first project with the malaria parasite. So 25 years I've been working with malaria. And one of the things there is that I worked for a guy called John Hyde, and John Hyde was at alma mater, was at Edinburgh, and he said, oh, I'll put you in contact with somebody up there, and you should do a PhD with him. And so, sure enough, 1992, I moved to the University of Edinburgh. Gorgeous city, as you'd imagine. It's a very young and slightly similar-looking version of me. Interestingly, I was on my third PhD supervisor before I even started my PhD. I was actually recruited by a guy called John Scaife, who unfortunately died in that process between being selected for his PhD. And then I was passed on to Rob Ridley, who then went on to work for Roche and delivered larium to the community. And so when I did start, I ended up working for a guy called Professor Brian Kilby. And unfortunately, I've spent quite a while trying to find a picture of Brian, but I didn't manage to find him. And so in 1996, I graduated with a PhD in molecular parasitology. And you can see that sort of rather long PhD title. And actually, there's this social media meme that says, can you actually come up with a much more amusing way of describing your PhD thesis? And mine was, parasites turn on proteins that make DNA just before they make DNA. At the time, the reverberations that went through the community were astounding. As you can imagine, people were very shocked. But three things came out of my time when I was in Edinburgh. One is that I learned to genetically manipulate the parasite. And this was important. I was the first person in the UK, probably Europe, to actually be able to do that. And actually what it did is it actually meant that when I met Michael Lanza, the second most important thing that happened at that time there, Michael Lanza said, why don't you come out and work with me in Germany? And the third thing was, at the end of my first year, there was a new PhD student, and we went out, and I was saying, oh, you should come and do this. And this was Kerry, and Kerry ended up being my wife. So, three important things from Edinburgh. So, when I finished, I moved over to Germany. So this was the guy I worked for, Michael Lanza, or Mike, as I used to call him. And we worked in, you know, it's a beautiful city. And actually, our institute, the Zentrum für Infektionsforschung, was on Röntgenring. So the ring road around it is named after the guy who discovered the X-ray. So Röntgen, so that would be over here somewhere. It was a great time. I was a wissenschaftlicher Angestellter, which it's spelt hopefully correctly. But during that time, one of the things that I learned was instead of, we used to work with bits of DNA that were a bit of a gene, or perhaps a whole gene with a little bit around it. But I started to work at that time with things called yeast artificial chromosomes, and what you were able to do there is you were able to take bits of DNA that had hundreds of genes attached to it. And it was that, when I went for an interview in Oxford, that they said, right, you should come over and join us. And I joined, at that time, what was really this was the start of the sequencing of the Plasmodium falciparum genome project, so the first malaria genome project. So here, this is obviously the Dreaming Spires of Oxford, and this is the institute here. It's now, of course, now the Weatherall Institute of Molecular Medicine, and my lab would have been just around the corner from there. I work for a guy called Professor Newbold. And the one thing that I've got from Professor Newbold is the idea that he was an interesting person to work for. The amount of ideas that he came up with, he was firing on cylinders all the time, and he was really, really bright. And he would walk into an office, and, you know, there was seven or eight postdocs stuck in this office, and he'd go, I was just thinking about. And then you go, okay, that's a great idea, Chris. But the second time, and then the third time he said it, somebody went off and did it in the lab. And invariably, it was a great idea. And the other thing that was great about working in Oxford is that we were part of a tropical network. So we actually got to collaborate with and work with colleagues over in Vietnam, Thailand, Africa and Kenya, and so on. And actually, at this time, my wife had joined me in Oxford this time. She worked for somebody else who was part of this tropical network. So we actually got to go on some nice holidays together as a result of going to these network meetings. And this is us in Tanzania. So, working on the genome project. The other great thing about Chris is he was the opportunity, if you had an idea, he was very good at developing you to the point where you went and flew the nest. And one of the things, and actually this is wonderful, is that actually I said to him, I need to go somewhere else to do the work I want to do. I want to go to Liverpool to do this work. And he says, fine, I'll carry on paying you, I'll carry on supporting you, but go and do it in Liverpool. And so here in 2002, I went up and I moved to Liverpool, to the Liverpool School of Tropical Medicine, and I worked with Professor Alistair Craig, fantastic, wonderful colleague. Several in the audience will actually know him. And this is a nod to Nick. I don't know where Nick is in the audience. I'm looking for a bright clothing. There you go, Nick. Thank you very much. So Nick gave his inaugural a couple of weeks ago. A picture of him in his kilt. And I thought, I'll do that as well. So this is me on my wedding day. This is my brother, who's my best man. As you can see, I think I can carry it off. So I was working in Liverpool. And whilst I was there, I applied for a Royal Society Fellowship. And this Royal Society Fellowship, I was awarded it. But at the same time, as I came for an interview with Lindsay Bashford, who's also in the audience over there, and the School of Medicine, which is in the other David Weatherall building down here, was really starting to ramp up in terms of its recruitment of staff. And it was at that time he said, well, why don't you come over here, and why don't you bring your grant with you as well? Now I've been in that situation, I do enjoy saying to people, why don't you bring your grant with you as you come to work for us? So I did, and I joined the Centre for Applied Entomology and Parasitology, which then was within the Institute of Science and Technology. It's slightly separate now, but I like to think that I sort of sit and bridge those gaps there. So, I have been here for 12 years now, and gone from a fellow to lecturer, senior lecturer, and a couple of years ago, obviously, I was moved up to professor. Wonderful thing, and this is the great thing about working in science. Science is about people. It's about working with people. It's collaborating. It's sharing ideas. And these are some of the people I've had the privilege to work with within my laboratory. And you can see there's the occasional group photos. I am in this picture twice. This was a present from my PBL group. It was a cardboard cutout of me. How they knew me after such a short period of time, I have no idea. But anyway, and key people on here, this is Ellie. This is Karen, this is Imran, these are PhD students who have graduated from my laboratory. This one I'm particularly proud of. This is Fatou and Hadi, both did masters within my laboratory, and they've actually both then went back to the Gambia to work at the Medical Research Council unit, and they're actually delivering research in West Africa. And it's a wonderful thing, is within the last year and a half, both of them have subsequently gone on to do their PhDs as well. And talking about someone going on to the PhD, I know that Fahana's in the audience. Thank you, there she is down there. And so Fahana's also recently started a PhD as well. So it's great, and that's what I love. It's about working with people. So, malaria. Everybody knows about malaria, but actually when you ask them the details of malaria, they're actually quite confused in terms of their, what we call nomenclature, the description of what actually malaria is. Malaria isn't a parasite. Malaria isn't a virus. It's not a bacteria. It's not a mosquito. It's a disease. It's something that humans suffer from. It can be described in two terms, something we call uncomplicated and something severe. To all intents and purposes, uncomplicated malaria, if we were to wake up vomiting, headache, joint pains, muscle pain, and things like that, fever, we would assume we have flu. If you live in malaria-endemic regions, you don't assume you have flu, you assume you have malaria. And that's actually, for the vast majority of people, and hundreds of millions of episodes of malaria happen every single year. Sometimes it becomes severe. When it gets severe, we start to get complications where we start to have organs within the body shutting down. So the placenta starts to shut down in pregnancy-associated malaria. The brain shuts down in cerebral malaria. You get problems with the lungs and breathing and the kidney as well. So that's when it becomes severe. And unfortunately, in some of those cases, it does lead to death. Now, hundreds of millions of people get malaria every year. Currently, at the moment, we're probably talking about 300 to 500,000 people die from malaria every year. And those are the figures from a couple of years ago. Tragically, 90% of all these deaths occur in young children. These are children aged under 5 years and predominantly West and Central Africa. And that's part of this whole thing about the number game. It's actually a very small proportion of people die from the parasite or from the disease caused by the parasite. But unfortunately, the vast number of people that suffer from the disease ultimately funnel down to create those large numbers of deaths. So it's caused by a microorganism. Micro meaning it's very small and it fits inside our cells. And this is the picture that was used to advertise the seminar. This is a red blood cell, and here's some of these merozoites, which are bursting out of this red blood cell and getting ready to invade another cell. Here they would form a ring, and then these mature into trophozoites, and you can see it starting to segment up again, and it will burst out. Okay, and that's what it is. It's a eukaryotic microorganism that lives inside our cells of our body. It's caused by parasites from what we call the Plasmodium family. There's a small number of those which infect humans, but of all of those, the one called Plasmodium falciparum is the most virulent. And that's the one I'm going to talk about today, because that's the only one I've worked on. Now, when I was training as a PhD scientist in Edinburgh, someone said, you can't talk about parasitology without showing the life cycle. Now, the life cycle is complex, and this is meant to confuse you and look scary, okay? It's not everyone going, oh, God, look at them do that. It is a complex life cycle. There's parts happen within the mosquito, some parts happen within the human. So the vector, when it bites you and feeds off your blood, it injects the mosquito into you, it goes through a liver stage, and then it gets into the blood. And when it gets into the blood, and most of the work I'm going to talk about today is all about this blood stage, and the reason why is that's when you get the disease. In the liver, it's asymptomatic. It's the latent stage of the disease. So it's the blood stage that causes the disease. And after a while, some of them form as sexual forms, and these get taken up. They complete their life cycle within mosquito, and then they get spread again. So, taking that life cycle and making it simpler, let's think about the key aspects of it. If we're going to interfere and block this disease, let's think about two key points. One is it's spread by a mosquito and people suffer from it. So, if you're thinking about a control strategy, great idea is get rid of the mosquitoes. And that's what indoor residual spraying does. You take some DDT, you know that they're going to sit around the high elements of the room. You go around and you spray those and you leave it on there and it will kill a mosquito. Better still, don't get bitten. Sleep under a bed net, preferably a bed net that's got insecticide impregnated into it. And so that's the most important, is the fundamental aspect of control. Don't get the disease. Sometimes you get bitten. Now, when you travel to Southeast Asia or Africa and you have your nice holidays, sometimes you get your malaria tablets. And what so that's a prophylactic. That's saying, let's load up with a drug so that if the parasite comes along, there'll be drug in your system already and that will get rid of it. So that's the prophylaxis. There is currently some potential for a vaccine. And I'm very aware of the fact that this is being videotaped. There is some potential for a vaccine. Let's leave it at that. There's lots of very clever people working in this area, and they're delivering the product at the moment. I suspect within the next 5 years, we will actually see a widespread rollout of the vaccine into the field. However, if you're bitten and the parasite does manage to get to establish a niche within you, the next thing is treat the infection. So first of all, diagnostics. We have some fantastic diagnostics. You don't want to be based on fancy techniques. It's going to be something. Get a bit of blood, put it in a tube, stick something that looks like a pregnancy test into it, leave it for a minute, pull it out, and it's going to say yes or no. So that's the rapid test that we use. We've got a couple of them in the laboratory. We've been looking at those. It's quite interesting. The next important thing is treat the symptoms of the disease. When someone comes in and they're hospitalized, and the fact is that they've been taken to the hospital, must mean that they're very ill, because quite often you have to travel a substantial distance to do that. Symptomatic management of the disease. There's a very good chance that they're going to be hypertensive, they're going to have respiratory distress, they're going to be acidotic. So treat and manage the symptoms. But the next most important thing that you can do after that is get rid of the parasites. They're causing the problem. They're going to go on to cause the problem, and it may kill the host. So the best thing you can do is get some drugs into that person. And these are treatment-based drugs as opposed to prophylactic drugs. They have different characteristics. So that's how you interfere and break the cycle. So this is WHO figures from a report a couple of years ago, and it's changes. It maps the changes in global mortality. It's broken down by different regions, but this is the big trend figure that you're going to be looking at. You can see it started in the 80s. And what I've done is I've indicated over here, this is what's happened to global mortality over my career. So certainly at the start of my career, deaths were substantially increasing. Chloroquine was failing. That was the mainstay of treatment at the time, and there was widespread resistance. Insecticide treatment wasn't working, and people were starting to really ramp up in terms of actually addressing the fact that almost 2 million people every year were dying. You remember Band-Aid and things like that, where the guy stands at the front and clicks his finger like this and says, every time I click a finger, a child in Africa dies. And that was that era. Since 2000, we've had the establishment of the Millennium Goals, and we've now had a substantial and a continuing decline in deaths. So mortality and morbidity is falling. This is Africa, and what we have here is a heat map. The hotter the colour, the more prevalent the disease. And you can see this is where we were at the turn of the century. Very hot, West Africa, Central Africa, DR, Congo, Central African Republic, going down to the coastal regions down here of Kenya, Tanzania, and so on like that. Roll forward 15 years, and you can see it's a lot cooler. Yeah, deaths have reduced. You know, we've had a 60% reduction in deaths, 30% reduction in incidence of disease, and it's falling. And why? We've got better drugs. We've got amazing drugs. Artemisinin combination therapy is the bee's knees. Insecticide spraying, we've talked about. Insect-treated bed nets. They've saved millions of lives over the last decade. Improved diagnostics, better understanding of management, better access for facilities, and most important of all, money. Lots and lots of money. When we talk about the UK donating, it's a proportion of its GDP for overseas aid. This is what it's delivering. So what about the future? This is artemisinin, the bee's knees. Artemisinin is starting to fail. Southeast Asia, there's evidence of artemisinin resistance. It's now well characterized and described. Worryingly, it's spreading into Africa. If it gets into Africa and gets a foothold in Africa, deaths will start to go back on the increase. Importantly as well, insecticide resistance in the mosquitoes. They're becoming resistant to not only one, but two, and perhaps even three of these commonly used insecticides. So, rail back a bit. Why did I choose molecular biology? So this is the bit where you can't make molecular biology interesting. So, When I was in my lower sixth, I had the opportunity to go to Leeds University for a week, and I did a research project in the molecular biology labs there. I thought it was amazing. In retrospect, looking back, all I did was a mini prep, a digest, and run it on the gel. But at the time, I thought I understood antibiotic resistance. But the idea that you could actually study how cells function at the molecular level and understand that, I find fascinating. I can't explain how an engine works. I'm not a Scooby. You put petrol in, or diesel, depending on which it is, and it says on the label, and that's it. But actually, when it comes to the cells, I think this is fascinating. As a field, it started in the 1930s, but really it got solidified in 1962, the Nobel Prize for the description of the structure of DNA, Watson, Crick, and Franklin. And they actually defined the structure of DNA. From there, we understood how information flowed, or the flow of biological information through a cell. Now, I started in the early 1990s, and the reason why I felt it was great in the early 1990s is the tools to do something with the DNA really ramped up at that point. We had ligases, we had restriction enzymes, we had the ability to clone, amplify DNA. All of those technologies started in the early 1990s, and that's where I came into the laboratory. But this is the unfortunate question that you always worry about when your child says to you, so what do you actually do? What I actually do quite often, well, used to do, but not so much nowadays, is I take little tubes with clear liquid and I move one from here into this one here. And I do it a lot. Okay? That's what molecular biologists do. We just move one clear liquid into the next. We carefully measure it, but that's what we do. We then cast an agarose gel. And then we talk about bands on that gel. In fact, only in lunchtime today, we were talking about bands on a gel. And that's what we do. So when you see scientists talking about bands, they're not cool. They're just talking about these bands here. And that's what we actually do. We talk about bands a lot. Now, one of those guys we were talking about there in terms of the flow of information within a cell was Watson and Crick and Franklin. Now, Crick, in the 60s, defined or to describe something which he called the central dogma. Got a lot of criticism, particularly from Jacques Monod, about this, because he said, you don't understand what dogma means. That wasn't actually the funny part. But really, this is a key thing we've got to think about. DNA. DNA is just a long strand of molecules. Within that strand of molecules, there are things called genes. Genes are your information. This is what makes you. It's the gene. Every so often when the cell divides, it has to replicate its DNA and make another copy. Okay? Now, when it wants to do something, it looks at the gene and says, okay, of all of this DNA, I'm interested in this part of the gene, and I'm going to transcribe it. I'm going to write it out again. And it uses a different type of nucleic acid called ribonucleic acid to do this. So that process is called transcription. Now, the RNA then gets translated and it's made into a protein. Proteins are what do things in cells. Yeah, they've got lots and lots of entropy within them. They do things. That's what builds cells. It's what does all the catabolism and anabolism and all those other things like that. So, move forward 20, 30 years. And actually, this is the problem with Crick's central dogma. It kind of falls apart a bit. So, RNA, so it's not always DNA, RNA, protein, because RNA never goes into DNA if it's an RNA virus, and so it just replicates itself here. Some RNA viruses actually make DNA and go backwards up this process and incorporate themselves within the DNA. Proteins actually modify other proteins. And that's actually a very common phenomenon, post-translational modifications. In fact, some proteins get damaged and mutate, and then they do this to other proteins. And these are called prions. And actually, the idea that you can actually generate another... A big debate within the science community is, are prions actually alive? We don't know. But the idea is that they can actually modify each other. And DNA doesn't operate in isolation. DNA is wrapped in protein. And the process of how that protein is wrapped around it directs how this DNA can be used. And this field's called epigenetics. And certainly when I started in molecular biology, epigenetics was a kind of an interesting new area. But now actually underpins most everything that we understand about how cells work. So, when I started working And this is a feature when I actually work, when I actually move on to a slide and where areas I work, I'll show up here the badge where we, of the university where I worked. So this is this red blood, this is the red blood cell cycle. The parasite invades, it adapts, it changes and it recognizes its environment, and then it changes its environment to say, this is what I want for my home, and then it starts to divide, and when it divides, it ruptures and bursts out. And so certainly one of the things I was interested in is, how are genes turned on, and how are they turned off as the parasite moves through this cycle? Morphologically, we see that there's vast changes. You've got the rings, you've got the trophs, you've got the schizons, what happens, where the cell's located within the body, all of those things like that. So on a gene-by-gene basis, this is what I used to do. And I used to then say, how is this control exerting? This is an image from Karen's PhD thesis, where she's trying to overlay on top of the DNA, the RNA, and the protein, some of what we now understand about how genetic information within a malaria parasite is controlled. And importantly, as a genetic engineer, I actually say, if I change this and I do this, what happens? So that's what I used to do on a gene-by-gene basis. But when I moved to Oxford, it changed. I was joined part of a UK-USA initiative in Oxford. Within the UK, it was Oxford linked to the Sanger Centre over in Cambridge. And we actually recognised there was 14 chromosomes within the parasite, 5,700-odd genes, 25 million base pairs, so we just sequenced the whole lot. And actually what that meant for me was is that I actually used to have lots and lots of gel apparatus all set up, and I would load DNA on it, run it out, it'd take 3 to 5 days to run it out, and then I would cut out the DNA, purify it, and send it off for sequencing. Chromosomes 1, 3, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 13, etched into my soul. At one point, we worked out that I isolated 65% of the DNA that was actually sequenced to the first genome. It took us years to do the first genome. Now, what did you say, Catherine? A couple of weeks at most to actually do it now? Yeah, years at that time. So I spent isolating doing that. But the research dynamic changed. And let's go back to this idea, DNA to RNA to protein. When you understand all the genes within a DNA, you've described the genome. So it's called genomics. That's the field. Now, some wag, when they thought, oh, let's describe all the RNA within a cell, called it transcriptomics. And obviously, as that leads on, proteinomics. And people talk about the omics. This is what they mean. It's where you actually look at all of the content of that various thing. And that's moved on. Now, it seems that the cool thing that you can actually do is you can actually identify an area and call it and stick an omic at the end, and it takes you up a few factors when it goes to your impact factors in your publication. We need to think about this, Catherine. Metabolomics, lipidomics, glycomics, kinetomics, interactomics, they're all there, and there's so many of them. But what it meant for me as a research scientist is I stopped working on a gene-to-gene basis. I've started working with all genes, all transcripts, all proteins. And the other phenomenon that happens with that is when you actually start getting these large projects, this is the Nature paper that described the sequence of 1, 3, 4, stop. You actually get buried in the middle of it. There's 130-odd authors on this paper here. But also I've worked with transcriptomics, I've also worked with proteomics, and certainly one of the things I was quite pleased with, and this was really quite nice, I was a new postdoc, and I was actually invited by the WHO for their World Health Bulletin to actually write a review about what are we doing in these areas and what does it mean for the future. And so this is what we did. We now work with thousands of genes, thousands of transcripts, thousands of proteins. Now, This is a family tree. When you describe proteins, and it's called a family tree because what we've done here is we've stepped up a gear. We don't just look at Plasmodium falciparum. We look at Nolsii, Vivax, Ovale. And then we extend beyond that and we actually say, well, Cryptosporidium is a related parasite. Babesia is a related parasite. And so you take all of these related parasites, their genomes are now being sequenced, and now you start to look at all of the information across all of these pathogens that are related to each other. And so this work here describes work on something called the You don't need to worry too much about that. It's about proteins that modify other proteins. And here we have, so we looked at over 4,000 genes in these 13 organisms, and this is how the family tree works out. So these are what we call orthologs. They have the same function within the different organisms, and you can see they're all close related to each other. Now here, this is polyubiquitin. Polyubiquitin was the first gene that I worked on when I was at UMIST. I only cloned a fraction of the gene, a tiny little bit of it, during my honours project. When I got to Oxford and I worked on the genome project, just one day, the whole thing dropped out in front of me. I was just analysing the data, the whole gene there. Wrote that paper in 3 months, got that published. And so that was the first gene I ever worked on. This gene here, ATG8, remember that. We're going to meet ATG8 later. Now, this is the great thing about being a research scientist. We love to collaborate. We love to talk. Most of the time it's to say to other people, yeah, the work we're doing is amazing. Yes, you know, anything like that. But actually, a lot of it is about saying, you've got that. Well, I've got this. Why don't we get together? We'll share, we'll collaborate, and we'll do things. And it's the power of our science is brought together by our ability to collaborate and work with each other. And then we fold in the next thing. We bring computers to play. I spend more time doing biology on a computer than I do in the laboratory. I do things and I go to the laboratory and go, yep, it's right, and then come back. And we spend more time there. And also, and there's a nod to the mathematicians in the room, we like to model things and then ask, are our models correct? And so we bring all these things. And these are all these related parasites. And so we can do things. Here, this is a paper that we did where we describe protein networks that control the start of transcription of initiation. Here, we actually combined histone data, a completely different data set from some colleagues in the US, and actually then merged that with our data and actually said, well, actually, no, this tells us something about how DNA is organized at transcription start sites. And then we actually did mathematical modeling. Now, the reason why I like putting this graph in, this is my second favorite figure that I've ever produced. We'll meet my first favorite figure later on. And the reason why is there's 6 million data points went into the generation of that figure. And there was two of them. So that was 12 million data points. She did get a PhD. But actually, at the end, you just look at it and go, it just seems a series of curves. There's some interesting biology behind that. But 6 million data points where we modeled what we thought was actually happening. So, hopefully, I've convinced you that molecular biology isn't boring. But let's move into the cell biology, and let's recognize, back to the basics, malaria is a disease. This is a red blood cell. You can see its beautiful biconcave shape. And this is a parasitized red blood cell. It's lost that biconcave shape. It's crenulated. It's got all these perturbations on the surface. This cell is very sticky. It likes to stick to other cells in the human body. Here you can see it stuck to other red blood cells. Here you can see it stuck to an immune cell and actually stopping that immune cell functioning properly. So this is like very fancy electron microscopy. It's like a very powerful microscope. What you see here in grey there, that's an endothelial cell. So an endothelial cell is what lines all your blood vessels. And at the moment, that's what it looks like on the sheet. But in real life, it's wrapped up like that. Now, if you imagine the space that you can see down here and the size of those red blood cells sticking within that, you can see where the pathology arises. They get blocked. They get blocked. Blood stops flowing. No oxygen gets delivered to the organs. And that's where the pathogenesis arises from. So, move on to the next one. If you take that red blood cell and cut it, and look at the surface through a transection. This is the red blood cell surface. This is the inside of the red blood cell. And this is the parasite sat inside. But you can see these electron-dense protrusions here. And this is where we're all going to have to be very mature. We call them knobs. And I'm going to use the word knob and knobby quite frequently to describe this. But these knobs are on the surface, and you can see these little decorations here. These are gold particles. And what I've done is I've added an antibody here to a protein called erythrocyte membrane protein 1, PFEMP1. That's stuck outside of the red blood cell. It's made by the parasite, it's transported to the surface, and it's loaded onto these knobs, and it sticks out onto the surface. PFEMP1 is the most important protein If you're going to look at one protein in the malaria parasite, it's PFEMP1. It's absolutely central. And the reason is it causes the stickiness. This is a parasite. This is a special type of electron microscopy where we freeze it and we can pull back membrane layers. And as we do this, you can see inside here, this is the parasite inside, and this is part of the red blood cell membrane which sits on top. And when you go down to detail, you can see these regular array, it's actually a hexagonal array of these knobby knobby structures. Those knobby structures here, and this is an endothelial cell, so this is the lining of the red blood cell, and when you zoom in right at these ends here, you can see these proteinaceous bridges. This is PFEMP1 reaching out from the surface of the red blood cell on these knobs and binding and forming these bridges or these protein anchors with the host cell. And that is the molecular basis of that adhesion phenotype. So, PFEMP1 projects from the knobs. But why have knobs? What advantage is it actually conferring on the cell? PFMP1 goes to the surface if you get rid of knobs, and we demonstrated that. And here what we've done is I've made a knobless parasite. And you can see here we've done the same peel back. You can see there's no knobs here. But what we've done is where we look at we count how many cells are binding to the endothelium. And when we do it under static conditions, that is we just sit it on top and leave it sat there, lots bind, and they bind equally. But then what you do is you introduce flow, because blood flows over endothelial cells. And when you do this, what you see is that in the knobless parasites, many fewer stick. And so to actually cause that adhesion, or to support that adhesion to endothelial cells under flow, the knobs have to be present. So that's what that figure demonstrates there. Now, I did that work. That was the project that took me up to Liverpool. And there's a great link to Liverpool here. It's a principle of fluid dynamics, microfluid dynamics, that ruffled surfaces, bumped surfaces, actually increase adhesive properties. And the reason why this is interesting is this guy here, Craig Johnson, he was an Australian. He came over, he was actually one of the first Australians to make the big break into European football, played for Liverpool in the 80s and sort of left in the early 90s to go back to Australia. There he patented the Predator football boot, the precursor of actually many generations now of football boots, with bumpled and wrinkled surfaces on the football boot because it enhances control, because they stick better. And that is the tenuous Liverpool connection. It works so much better in Liverpool than it does here. Okay, so that's the knobs. But we go back to PFEMP1. So PFEMP1 projects from the surface. This is it flowing down this capillary, and here you can see there's the endothelial lining. It sticks to these things, it binds and blocks. Sometimes it causes leakages as it breaks down the barriers between these things here. It causes a large secretion of pro-inflammatory molecules. And the reason why, so the parasites somehow, what it's done is it's found the red blood cell. The red blood cell is a very interesting cell. It doesn't have the capacity to present antigens onto the surface. So immunologically, it's a great place to hide. It doesn't go around advertising the surface, it doesn't go around advertising to the immune system. It has a problem. But the parasite then puts something on the surface, which the immune system then recognizes. And the reason why it does that is it wants to stick. Sticking is much more important than hiding. And the reason why is this environment here is low in oxygen, Nick. Oh, he's gone. Nick, it's low in oxygen. Okay. And it's a microaerophile. It grows best under these conditions. But the other thing as well is it's trying to avoid going through an organ within your body called the spleen. The spleen recognizes damaged red blood cells and gets rid of it. Hence, one of the presentations of someone with severe malaria is splenomegaly, because their spleen is enlarged because it's spending all of its time getting rid of damaged red blood cells. So it's found this great place to hide. But because of that, and by presenting the PFMP1 on the surface, it becomes recognized by the immune system. So the secret now is, how do you stay ahead of the immune system? And it uses what we call clonal antigenic variation, and I will explain what this means. This is a chromosome. This is one of those 14 chromosomes within the parasite. Therefore, there's 28 ends. And as you go from a chromosome end, the first gene that you will bump into as you walk in from the chromosome end is a var gene. And these are the var genes. So if most chromosome ends, the first gene you bump into is a var gene. Var genes, and there's 60 of them within the parasite, about 60, make PFE and P1. Here, this is the blue var gene, and because of that, blue PFE and P1 is on the red blood cell surface. They've escaped from the liver. As they all escape from the liver, as they leave the liver, they all shout, blue, and they switch on the blue var gene. Over time, a small proportion of them go, not blue, I'm going to switch. And so what happens is that gene turns off, and this one turns on, and this one's yellow. And so within that population, you have blue cells, but you also have a yellow cell. Now let's put the immune system on top of that. There's our blue cells, and as they're circulating around the body, the immune system starts to go, ah, blue, I've seen blue. And so it starts to make antibodies. And as it starts that process of developing and making those antibodies, some of these have switched. Now these blue antibodies come in and wipe out these blue parasites. Now the yellow ones, the immune system's never seen before. So they escape, they expand, they repopulate, and the immune system then starts to move on to say, yellow, we've got to find and attack yellow. Now, the parasite has got 60 var gene variants, and it will rotate and move through those, effectively staying one step ahead of the immune system. And it has to do this because the reason of the parasite and its only raison d'etre is get into the human, stay in the human, until you can be spread to the next a host. And so you've got to stay. It's a very dangerous environment for it, so it has to exist and persist. Now, that persistence could be months. In some areas of Africa, the transmission dry seasons can be months long. And so it's got to stay inside the human host for a long period of time. Right, this one slide summarizes 2 years' worth of work. During this time, working with, predominantly with Bob Pinches and Sue Kies in particular, we've maintained 100 flasks of parasites, all different parasite strains, for a period of 6 months. And so my family went and see that, when you saw that incubator earlier, there was 100 of those flasks stacked up inside of one of those things. And every day we would go in, we would change the medium, we would look after them, smear them, check them, and move on to the next one. So 100 flasks we kept going. And we measured the protein and the RNA levels for this PFE and P1. And that's summarized in this figure here. And what we saw was, it's not random. As it moves from its blue to its yellow to its red, it's not random. There's something underpinning that process that means that it becomes more efficient in how it uses those antigens. So they switch at different rates. Some are fast, some are slow. So the fast ones the immune system sees earlier, the slow ones it sees later on. Some switches, for example, blue to yellow, are allowed, but blue to red isn't allowed. So it sets up these networks. And actually what it does is it establishes a hierarchy of var gene switches, which is still being modelled at the moment and work's still going on in this area. And what that does is it actually allows us to understand the stochastic nature of var gene switching and why and how the parasite manages to establish an infection and stay in a human host, despite the immune system being very proactive in targeting it. So, killing parasites. This is really, we've talked about the disease, but actually, clinicians in the audience, you want to kill it. Simple as. Okay. So, artemisinins, these are these wonderful drugs we talked about. Resistance is on the rise. We need new treatments, and it's very easy when it comes to malaria, antimalarial drugs. They've got to be safe. Lots of people are taking them. Lots of children are taking them. Lots of pregnant women are taking them. Two target groups, pharmaceutical companies really don't like designing drugs to. They've got to be cheap. Think of your target. You've got to be able to deliver a drug which is a dollar, essentially, for a curative dose. And they have to be effective. And the important aspect of this effectiveness is the speed at which it kills. Remember the situation. The child comes in, prone, 2 years old, floppy, acidotic, respiratory distress, probably a real risk of dying over the next 16 to 24 hours. You want to get rid of as many of those parasites as you can, as quickly as you can. And that's where artemisinin is amazing. It does that. So there's lots and lots of drugs. There's lots and lots of compounds that we know kill the malaria parasite. And this has been a great thing that GSK, AstraZeneca, and all these other companies, they've donated essentially their compound library sets, millions of compounds. But there's a compound, and then there's a drug, and there's a long pathway in between. And it's a very long, so it's an expensive pathway, and it's also lots of, at this point here, and it eventually comes down to one drug at the end. So the question is, of these 2 million here, how do you find that one here that is actually going to be the one that gets rolled out and actually used as a treatment? So, and this is where the work of our laboratory came in. A few years ago in Glasgow, in a wine bar, I went for a coffee, but we ended up having a bar, I met Sanjeev Krishna. And Sanjeev Krishna was explaining to me, he says, the real problem we have is we need to be able to work out how fast a drug kills a parasite and do this before we actually put that drug in a human. So we need a laboratory test to do this. And at that point, I was working on something called a luciferase. And luciferase is a great instrument for a laboratory. It's a common tool that we use. It's a protein made by the parasite. And when you add a luminescent molecule, it actually bioluminesces. You get light, and you can measure that light. Now, the problem is when you're trying to measure how fast something dies, is you have to be able to have something you can measure that says, this is it, it's gone down. The problem is that most people use, and the most common biomarker we use is DNA. DNA isn't that useful a biomarker for when you're looking at quick things. And the reason for this is it's very stable. A parasite that is dead will still have DNA in it, and it will take time for that DNA to disappear. So you don't get a dynamic response. But one thing it doesn't do is it doesn't make new protein. And when that protein gets turned over, you can see very quickly that when the parasite dies, the amount of luciferase goes down, and the amount of light goes down. And so what we did is we took an assay that currently takes 4 weeks, and there's a guy called Imran Ullah, who's a PhD student in my laboratory, he made it into a six-hour assay. And that was his PhD project. And it's a six-hour assay, and you can do it on microplates, and you can do hundreds of assays at the same time. And the idea, what we're trying to do, is we're trying to take drugs and actually identify at an earlier point those that are fast-acting. So his thesis was full of these graphs. He had 400 compounds, and he asked, is it fast or is it slow? Here, this is the light signal. It's going down, and it's going down. More drug, it goes down further. So this is good. This is fast. This, well, nothing's happening. So that's slow. This is moderate. And what he did is he did hundreds of these, and then we went to the mathematicians and say, help us understand this data and help us organize this data. And we used something called principal component analysis. And now this is my favorite figure that I've ever produced. On this graph, each one of these dots represents a discovery antimalarial. These are compounds that the community think have got some potential. There's some interesting things here. On this axis here, the x-axis, what we're saying here is how potent is this drug? And what we want is we want it so it's very potent. That is, if you add a small amount of the chemical, it kills lots of parasites. Because ultimately, it's got to be a tablet. And that tablet's got to be the size of a paracetamol so you can eat it. It can't be the size of a chocolate bar. It's not going to work. It'd be too expensive, too big, nobody will ever have it. So it has to be potent. So we want things potent, but also we want them fast. So the faster you are, the further you move down this line here because you have less bioluminescence. Now we know this, therefore, is the sweet spot. And the reason why it's the sweet spot is because it's potent and fast. And we know we've done it right because artemisinin sits smack in the middle of that sweet spot. It is fast and it is potent. Now, none of these discovery antimalarials sit in that sweet spot at the moment. But what we have here are a number of compounds which are fast, but they're not potent. So what we do is we go to our friends who are medicinal chemists, and I can see some in the audience here, and we look at them and we say, how do we change these and improve them so they move from here to go down to here? And that's essentially what we do. But it's the scale, and I'm always going to come back to the idea of scale. Imran spent 3 years with 400 compounds, and this was the malaria box. 5 plates, 80 drugs on each plate. He spent 3 years working those out. Got some good papers out of it. Toyin, who's in the audience somewhere here, so he's my PhD student, thank you. Toyin's at the back here. Now, she had another box, and it's called the pathophysiology box, another 400 compounds. She's been doing that work for 1 year, and she's already done that box. And it's off the back of this and the improvements that we've made in this assay that GSK have come to us and said, we've got 15,600 compounds. Can you tell us, are they fast or slow? And so we're working with them now, and they're plating these out, and they'll be sending them over. And I'm thinking perhaps a year, if that. But that's what we're hoping to do. Now, we said we'd come back to ATG8, and this is the last story. ATG8 is something which is part of what we call the autophagy pathway. And the reason why I wanted to talk about this project is all the other things are screening, but this is actually a bit more of a focused biology story. Autophagy was first described in yeast, and autophagy, self-eating, is a process that yeast uses when it has nutrient stress to say, actually, I'm going to start eating myself to derive the nutrients to continue living. The analogy being, if you're actually under conditions of starvation, you would start to use your fat, we would metabolize our fat, and then we'd then ultimately break down our muscle. And that's essentially, on a cell basis, that's what it does. Now, the parasite, it's clever, it's used this, it's looked at this process and said, yeah, that's kind of an interesting pathway. I'm not going to use it for this, I'm going to use it for something else. And what it actually does is it takes, for example, recycle organelles it doesn't need anymore. So it says, I've moved on, I don't need those anymore. And rather than just binning them, I'll actually digest them up and recycle them. So that's simply what it uses. Now, a key molecule or key enzyme at the start, or protein that started that process is ATGA. ATGA is here. ATGA interacts with something called ATG3. And this is part of ATG3. It's just a different representation to actually show how ATG3 sits along this cleft here. And this cleft here, which has got a W pocket and an L pocket, are where it sort of projects, and I think that's a tryptophan that projects into that pocket there. And so it sits along there, and that interaction is enough for it to then be recruited, becomes lipidated, and then it gets involved in this process of capturing and recycling components within what we call a phagosome, an autophagosome. Now, if we know that sits across there, and there's these two big pockets here, why don't we just design a small molecule that sits in that pocket and blocks the other ATG3 enzyme from binding with it? And here we've got, this is our leading candidate at the moment, and that's I think it's the W pocket there, and that'd be the L pocket there. And it sits and projects within that. And here, this in light green, you may not see it properly, but that's the ATG. And you can see that where that path of its interacting partner sits, we've stuck something in there to interfere with it. At the moment, it's modest in terms of its ability to inhibit. It's about a micromolar. But we understand why it's modest. Unfortunately, it doesn't like to dissolve in water. And I'm going to tell you, if you're going to design a tablet, it better dissolve in water. So we have to improve that. But we understand what we need to do in that area there. It's not the fastest, but it's moderate to fast. Certainly over a 48-hour dose, it'll do the job. So we're quite happy with that. And our early toxicity assays, and this is just using a liver cell line, and the liver's an important one to use because that's part of the body that does a lot of detoxifying, it doesn't seem to do much. It doesn't seem to affect the liver cells. So we're okay about that. And hopefully, if I can see Darren Moss in the audience, we're actually going to do a bit more advanced toxicology around these to actually establish whether these are going to be more than just a hit. And we know it works. And that's because This is our parasite here, inside the red blood cell. And here in green is the ATG8 protein. And there's the nucleus. And when you merge it, you can see here. So it was within the parasite. It localizes this blob here. When we add the drug, nothing really, it seems to look the same. And that's kind of interesting for us. Chloroquine, for example, if you add it, would actually cause lots and lots of autophagosomes to form. In fact, that's part of the reason why chloroquine is used as a drug in rheumatoid, for the control of rheumatoid arthritis, is that process of inducing autophagy within the target cells. But what we then do is we actually say, well, let's take cells and let's starve them. And when you starve them, you trigger this process of autophagy. Here you can see all of this ATG8 is burst out and it goes into these autophagosomes. But when you add the drug, it doesn't do that. So our prediction is that it wouldn't induce the formation of autophagosomes, it would inhibit it. And certainly our imaging data that we're having at the moment would support that we actually have what we think we should have. And this is work we've done in collaboration with colleagues over in the University of Washington. Now, electron microscopy. So I hasten to add this is work that's been done by Ibrahim, who's in my laboratory, and Ibrahim's somewhere in the audience. There he is. There we go. Thing like this. There's nothing Ibrahim loves more than doing a little bit of electron microscopy. So you know when I said the idea that chloroquine, when you would add chloroquine, you would get autophagosome formation, you get that vesicularization. Well, this is a chloroquine-treated cell, and can you see all these vesicles forming? It's a well-known phenomenon. There's an untreated cell, there's the normal formation of vesicles, but in the presence of chloroquine, lots and lots and lots of these vesicles get formed. Add our drug, you don't see them. We get slight enlargement of the digestive vacuole, less hemozoan formed. It doesn't do it. And the nice thing is that these are two different drugs. They look like each other. We think they should be doing the same thing, and luckily they look the same. If they look different, we'd be a bit worried. So actually, that looked quite promising. Now, not only we've got a number of drug projects going on in the laboratory. I've talked about Toyin's work here in terms of rate of kill, and Ibrahim does the autophagy project. This is Mugdad, yeah, there. So Mugdad works on heparins, and this is with colleagues in Liverpool and also within Keele, and the idea of how merozoites reinvade red blood cells, you can actually block that using heparin. Heparin is not a great drug to give to small, sick children or pregnant women. But if you can get rid of its anticoagulation property, and we can, then but still retain its blocking activity, it's got some legs. This is Hamza. Hamza is my leishmaniasis guy. Hamza just loves libraries and screening libraries. And one of the things he's working, he works with natural products. These are molecules from plants. And one of the things that he's actually identified is the Christmas tree, the common Christmas tree, the noble fir. If you actually extract a compound out of that, it kills the leishmaniasis parasite. And here is, and Viti's up here, and she does transcriptomics of cell death. Now, it's quite a busy slide, but this just actually, this is from me, and I'm recognizing again that I'm being videoed here, saying to my colleagues out there and also the funders, thank you for your support. It's been great working with you. And I apologize if we haven't been able to tell every story, but these are a vast array of people that we collaborate and work with. There's companies, academic centers, and so on and so on. But one thing I'd like to finish on is it's just a message. This is my granddad, my late granddad. Joseph Stanley Horrocks. One of the reasons my son is called Joseph is because both Kerry and I and our family have Josephs. And that's why Joseph's called Joseph. My granddad wasn't called Joseph, he was called Stanley. And he was known as Stan for years and years. And the reason why, he was on bomber air crew. When he turned up, there was already somebody called Joe on the aeroplane. I said, you can't be called Joe. Joe's called Joe, you have to be called something else. So he became Stan. And for his whole life, he was known as Stan. But he says, simple philosophy when it comes to a career. He says, there's three rules. The first rule is, you've got to love it. And that's wonderful. I wake up every morning, I bounce out of bed, and I do. I love working with students. I love working with my colleagues. I love the fact that I've got a diversity of colleagues, and that's not only within the university, but within medical school, within the hospitals. It's so great to see so many of you here. And it's a great environment to work with all these people. And I enjoy that. And also, I should hasten to add, more recently, more and more time was spent working with colleagues in Central University. The second thing is, he says it's got to pay. And I'm wary of the fact, Rose, Nick, Trevor, senior pay review this year, let's think about this. Okay. And the third thing is, he says, be proud of what you are. And the example he would say is, you're not a refuse collection agent. If you can't say you're a bin man, don't do the job. So, my final thank you is to my family, who's down here. And you can see this is my brother, my sister, myself, my mum and my dad, and my two kids and my wife, Kerry. And this is Amy, and this is Joe, and they're all down there at the bottom there. So from me to you, thank you so much for your support. I'm proud to say my name is Paul Horrocks. I'm the Professor of Molecular Parasitology at Keele University. Thank you.